So I should warn you that there are many, many slides in this presentation, and that those of you sitting on this side, including you, Richard, I think you're going to want to see the pictures. I should also apologize. I think I'm probably the only person here who has not produced a paper, and therefore this is going to take rather a different form now. I'm going to give you a paper.
It's also the reason why you get 5 minutes extra.
Indeed, I get slightly longer and you get slightly less. What I'm going to tell you today emerges from a project that I've been running over the last few years with a whole series of partners all down there. And I mentioned yesterday, this has sort of had quite a world ramification. This is this article in the San Paolo Daily newspaper I was talking about. You can see the bombers there and the tanks. Insofar as I understand Portuguese, I think it says the beginnings of the rule of law. And I did think, actually, given that I understand no Portuguese, I might give this paper in Portuguese because it would fit into the general sense that we're often talking about things about which we know very little. I think there are important points that Mario raised just there about the divisions in the way that we think about Magna Carta. There is the lawyer's Magna Carta, which is an excellent and wonderful thing, and I do not come certainly to bury that. There is also the popular understanding of Magna Carta and the historian's understanding of Magna Carta. And what I think you're going to get now is very much a historian's understanding of the popular understanding of Magna Carta. That picture itself should, I think, suggest to you that the idea that Magna Carta brought peace or the rule of law is actually a rather contentious one. It's all very well if you are an American economist to assume that Magna Carta brought you world prosperity and the rule of law. But if you are Indian or Jamaican or Irish, the idea that British lawyers brought you the rule of law is a very contentious one. I think the idea that Magna Carta in some way brought internal peace is a rather dangerous one. In the 800th anniversary year, we are only at war in limited parts of the Middle East. But in 1815, Britain was at war with Napoleon, and Britain itself was threatened with revolution. In 1715, Britain was at war internally as the result of a Jacobite rebellion against that settlement of 1689. In other words, I think that neither lawyers nor economists necessarily run the world, and there are dangers in anachronism. Talking of which, one of the reasons I didn't produce this paper was that 2 months ago, September, I was in Beijing. There I am with a team of people on the Great Wall. The inscription behind us reads, "The great helmsman is always right." I'm not quite sure why we were invited to Beijing at the invitation of the Chinese Foreign Office. I suspect that they believe Magna Carta, rather like Tutti Frutti or Hokey Cokey, to be some sort of Western entertainment. So certainly when they found out what Magna Carta was, there were ructions. So that the Hereford Magna Carta that was touring China at the time was sort of suspended in animation inside the British Embassy and not allowed to be exhibited publicly in either Shanghai or Beijing. A month after that, I was in Russia and in Armenia, and there I am in an Armenian restaurant with the reader in Armenian studies at the University of Oxford who has enjoyed quite a lot of Armenian wine, as you can see standing to my right, and the British ambassador selling Magna Carta to the Armenians. The purpose here, though, from my point of view, was fascinating because I realized that in a country like Armenia, to set up a stamp club or a village choir is a political act. And that the plurality of corporate entities that are mentioned in Magna Carta is one of the great strengths, one of the signs that even as early as 1215, Britain was already a fairly mature political system. So mature, indeed, of course, that as we understood yesterday, in 1215, the power of the monarchy was entirely abolished, together, really, with the power of the church. And that's why on the 15th of June 2015, I and Mervyn King and various others were there on the field of Runnymede, where the former Queen of England, Elizabeth II, her sovereign powers now utterly dented by Magna Carta, turned up to greet the local animal population, including the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Prime Minister, and the Duke of Edinburgh. Now, think about it. The Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh came from their house at Windsor Castle, where their ancestors were living in 1215. And the Archbishop of Canterbury came from Lambeth Palace, where Stephen Langton, Archbishop of Canterbury, emerged in June 1215 to arrange for Magna Carta. The Prime Minister there is, I think, worried about the imminent arrival of Mr. Putin. He's pointing upwards. Notice the great interest that the Duke of Edinburgh, as ever, takes in the nitty-gritty of these sorts of things. The heir to the throne was there, the future King of England, choosing some curtains for his wife, with the Minister of Justice, Michael Gove, if ever there were a contradiction in terms that I've just given it to you, with Michael Gove meeting some of the local population. And here we have the rededication of the American Bar Association spaceship on the site of Runnymede. Now, on the left there, you've got the Temple Choir. In the front, you've got the Attorney General of the United States and Princess Anne. And on the right, you've got a group of Americans dressed up as Templars. Now, precisely what the Knights Templars have to do with the rededication. Even the site of these events, Runnymede, came to the British nation in the 1920s as a result of purchase by Cara Lady Fairhaven, who was a daughter of Henry Hellhound Rogers, I think the name speaks quite a lot, who was one of the directors of Rockefeller's Standard Oil. She married an English sewage engineer, who you see on your left there, Urban Broughton, who brought sewage, or rather took it away, from Fairhaven, Massachusetts. And he became the first Lord Fairhaven. Look at the jaw of Lady Fairhaven and the descent of that jaw through the Fairhaven family thereafter. But Runnymede itself is a product of the interest in this particular family in acquiring an English peerage, which they did very successfully as a result. We heard from Judge Williams, I think very wisely, about this great story that Magna Carta tells, and also about Magna Carta as a rhetorical device. Well, here we have Winston Churchill in 1918 playing on the full rhetoric of this document as one of the three great title deeds of the liberties of the English-speaking people. It's for that reason that Ross Perot got interested in Magna Carta. He bought one in 1980. And in 2007, when he came to sell it, I was called into New York to write the catalogue. Interesting, Mr. Perot was asked at one point who he thought would buy his Magna Carta. I know who's going to buy my Magna Carta, he said. Who will that be? I know who it's going to be. Who will that be? The Queen of England. Why will the Queen of England buy it? So she can destroy it. Because if the Queen of England bought Magna Carta and got rid of it, then it would no longer have any validity. Well, thanks to that sale, Magna Carta was bought instead of by the Queen of England by David Rubinstein for $21.3 million, which is an extraordinary instance of the commodification of medieval history. It was really as a result of that sale in 2007 that I realized how little of the story behind all this had properly been told, and that we put together our project, which has been running for the last 3 years. We've heard a lot about those things, democracy, parliament, presumption of innocence, habeas corpus, and so forth, which, of course, are not in Magna Carta. We also heard very little yesterday about the things that are. In 2012, the New Hampshire Republicans decided that every amendment to their constitution henceforth should be preceded by a clause of the substantive 1215 Magna Carta. And one wonders whether they were thinking of that clause that forbids the charging of Jewish interest, or the clause that forbids women, save in cases involving the death of their husband, from pleading in court. The question was asked us now, are there things in Magna Carta that one regrets? Those would be amongst them. The expulsion of all foreigners might also cause some difficulties, both in the UK and in America. Well, clause 50, 51, all foreign mercenaries will leave the country, and a great long list of names, including the name of the Sheriff of Nottingham. So, King John is actually the reason I am going to suggest that the popular view of Magna Carta is today so powerful. That there is such a good story, again, as Judge Williams mentioned, behind all this. Now, the English, of course, are unusual here in having created a pantomime villain king. That has never happened in the history of the United States of America. But the creation of that myth takes us back quite a long way. As early as the 17th and 18th centuries, the press that King John received was not all good. He had, after all, encompassed the murder of his own nephew. Nonetheless, from the 16th century onwards, because of John's resistance to the Pope, John was read by people like Bale, and subsequently by Shakespeare, as essentially a tragic heroic figure. He was a king interested in the people of his realm being defended against the evil power of the Pope in Rome. As a result, those plays, like Shakespeare's play of King John, tended to focus upon the heroic element of King John as a resistor to foreign tyranny. The play of King John ends with a declaration that this England never did nor never shall lie at the proud foot of a conqueror. And those quotations from King John by Shakespeare were used in the debate over the Napoleonic Wars. The addition to that story of the Runnymede Magna Carta story is a product of the 19th century. And we find it at the end of the 19th century in Birbon Tree's playing of King John, where Birbon Tree added to Shakespeare's play this great scene at Runnymede. He also created the very first movie. The first appearance of Shakespeare in the movies is Birbon Tree playing King John at some time in the 1890s. Now that depended in turn upon a retelling of John's story that really takes us back to Sir Walter Scott. Walter Scott's Ivanhoe, although again it ends long before the events at Runnymede, supplies a version of King John as a foreigner surrounded by foreign, unpleasant rapists and thieves. And it also supplies the image of chivalric Englishmen, Ivanhoe in particular, standing up against the king. It also, for the first time, introduces into the story of Runnymede the story of Robin Hood, and with Robin Hood, that takes us on the road not only to Mel Brooks, but to Disney's Robin Hood, an image of the king very different from that of Bale or Shakespeare. It also presents an image of the chivalric Englishmen defending their rights against John as early as the 1190s, ultimately at Runnymede, that itself played into that category of the chivalric Englishman of the 1820s and 30s, represented in things like Kenelm Digby's Broadstone of Honour, the idea of the perfect English gentleman of the 19th century, which in turn was reflected in the first proper scholarly study of Magna Carta after Blackstone, Richard Thompson's 1829 book. Now, already by 1818, we find Hallam describing Magna Carta as the keystone of English liberty. All that has since been obtained is little more than a confirmation or commentary, and if every subsequent law were to be swept away, there would still remain the bold features that distinguish a free from a despotic monarchy. In this age of intellectual property theft, it's very interesting to see that virtually that entire phrase was lifted boldly into William Stubbs's constitutional history, where we're told that Magna Carta is the consummation of the work for which unconsciously kings and lawyers have been laboring. The whole of the constitutional history of England is little more than a commentary on Magna Carta. What balderdash. Now, all of this, of course, appealed to an age which was undergoing industrialization, in which Old Father Thames and the Lion of Britain were being confined to, well, what looks like a rather modern sewage system on the outskirts of a London slum. It feeds into that age that produced the Eglinton Tournament, a gathering of English noblemen led by Lord Eglinton, at which we are famously told of the knight who, because it rained very heavily and the tournament was called off, pulled out his umbrella. It fed into that ongoing fascination with the medievalism of Sir Walter Scott that in a sense reached its apogee in Sullivan's opera of Ivanhoe that appeared in 1891 to enormous success, the only greatly successful grand opera produced by an Englishman in the 19th century. I'm not going to give you the inner details of a whole series of rather awful but very popular Victorian novels that centre on King John and Magna Carta, beginning with John Edgar, continuing through Charlotte Mary Young, whose Constable Tower I've got here. And I have to say, I read it in Colorado, and it is truly terrible. Not quite as terrible as Warwick Deeping, who was the bête noir of George Orwell, but an immensely popular novelist. Warwick Deeping's Joan of the Tower, which takes the idea of Pelias from Maeterlinck and Debussy and turns the whole story of John's reign into a sort of symbolist fantasy. There are various common themes in those books, though. The king is a tyrant, and that's shown by the fact that he dresses in red. He's surrounded by foreign mercenaries. He is appalling in his behavior towards women. He is supported by a few brave people. This is undoubtedly where David Starkey got the idea of William Marshall, and I suspect that David Starkey knows about as much about William Marshall as I do about Henry VIII. And King John is also wildly associated in all of these books with wolves and particularly wild bulls, which incidentally shows that they are all copying one another. That obsession with wild bulls is rather fascinating because I think it takes us back to the idea of the Chillingham herd. This is this herd of wild cattle in the north of England. And that, too, takes us all the way back to Tacitus describing Britain as a land where the wild auroch roams free. A bit like the buffalo, the auroch was then killed by civilization. As an instance of all of this, I'll cite the example of Martin Tupper, who is the greatly awful philosopher of the 19th century. Tupper wrote an incredibly best-selling work called Proverbial Philosophy, which contains such wonderful things as "Seek a good wife of thy God, for she is the best gift of his providence," unless she isn't, and was particularly loathed by Marx. Marx described Martin Tupper as his pet aversion as violet powder. But of course, Tupper sold in the millions, whereas Marx did not. Now, in 1858, Tupper published a very popular book on Stephen Langton. It is utter nonsense, but it is full of the most fantastic instances of Victorian assumptions about Magna Carta. The king was guilty of diverse other acts of forcible criminal wantonness, whatever that may mean, against some high-born demoiselles. It sounds like the attempted... I was thinking of the Clinton case, which almost nothing but incipient madness could explain or excuse. It is Clinton. England was sick of him, so sick as to find in her loathing bosom a party almost base enough to welcome a French king. You've got to justify the fact that the barons actually supported the King of France against the King of England, so to present them as patriots was always rather difficult. The chief focus of Tupper's Stephen Langton is the story of King John spying on a naked woman in a pool outside Guildford. So horrified is she by this act of voyeurism that she commits suicide, which in turn brings Stephen Langton into the story and a lot of other hokum. But that itself was reflected in reality with the creation of a sort of monument to this completely non-existent woman outside Guildford, the silent pool. It also leads to the only physical commemoration of Stephen Langton today in England, which is a gastro pub outside Guildford called the Stephen Langton Arms. However, we heard quite a lot about Magna Carta yesterday that would fit into Martin Tupper's assessment of what it actually was. What was it? All tyrannies are cured by Magna Carta. You may amass and hold property, Richard, in peace. You may marry or not at your pleasure. You can make a will at your death with fair assurance of its execution. You can have a free church. Notice the rather Protestant quality of a free church. Just, impartial, independent judges, absolute liberty of coming and going, commerce, no tax of any kind without free choice. In a word, and notice this is actually 16 words, not a word, in a word, the Great Charter made Englishmen free and they were but slaves before it. Well, I've done a lot of travelling in America over the last few months, and I can assure you that that is definitely one version of the view of Magna Carta still held today. In terms of physical commemoration, it leads to the totemization of the site at Runnymede. The instance, for example, of the Ankerwyke yew, which is supposedly the tree under which King John signed Magna Carta. He would have had to crouch, I think, rather low. It appears in Jerome K. Jerome's Three Men in a Boat, where the heroes of that story go up the Thames and visit the table on which King John signed Magna Carta. That was put there in 1834 by a local landowner, George Simon Harcourt, who put up an inscription telling us that it was on this island in the Thames that King John signed Magna Carta. By this stage, Magna Carta had also entered the radical story, so that in Tom Brown, after his time at Rugby, in Tom Brown at Oxford, when Tom Brown develops radical tendencies, he buys a copy not only on the right of the execution warrant for Charles I, but of Magna Carta, and then holds a sort of Magna Carta dinner. All of this in the age where the Chartists themselves were looking back to Magna Carta as a symbol of liberty. All of this in an age where King John's totemic signing of Magna Carta using a nice ballpoint pen was becoming a constant theme in municipal and corporate architecture. For example, in the Mansion House in London in 1868, King John signing Magna Carta. In the Royal Exchange in 1900, King John signing Magna Carta. In the Northampton Guildhall in the 1860s, King John sort of handing out Magna Carta. At Burton-on-Trent, where King John unfortunately has fallen victim to the local pigeons, but is granting the men of Burton their charter. In the Middlesex Guildhall, 1912, that is now the Supreme Court of England, and again, King John is there handing out Magna Carta. It even appears in the House of Lords, where Charles Sims produced this rather symbolist rendering of Magna Carta in the 1920s. So unpopular was it, so socialist, that Charles Sims was hounded to an early death by drink and suicide. We find the same thing crossing the Atlantic, so that in the pulpit of the National Cathedral in New York, 1907, made from stone from Canterbury Cathedral, I'm not quite sure what King John is looking there. He's looking a little bit bewildered. He's been given something, and it looks as if he's trying to do it up with safety pins or something. But that clearly is Magna Carta. Again, a socialist rendering, Frank Brangwyn in the Cleveland, Ohio court, in the state capital at Madison, Wisconsin, where they've developed the idea now that King John didn't sign Magna Carta, but rather like JFK, when you come in and they stamp your passport. He's got a seal press there to do it properly. In Indiana, where they do things very differently, where King John is using a quill pen, and I suspect probably judges in the Indiana court still use quill pens. And of course, in the Washington Supreme Court, where these great brass doors of 1935 are decorated with an image of John stamping Magna Carta. In the north frieze of the courtroom of the Supreme Court, and indeed into the 1950s, on the front of the Los Angeles Superior Court, where we find a baron with Magna Carta as part of this totemic symbolism. I was in Denver a couple of days ago, and Denver has its own Magna Carta Park with its own football ground within Magna Carta Park. And I found this morning that New York City, since 1925, has had a mutual insurance carrier for the taxi cab industry called the Magna Carta Company. And you can see there a horse dressed in imperial purple as a symbol of this. Now, all of that really to say that what we have managed to do with our project is bring together quite a lot of this stuff, and you can go online and find quite a lot of it. We've also brought to light an awful lot more about Magna Carta. We found new Magna Cartas. We found who actually wrote it, when it was written. We found an awful lot of the subsidiary documentation that goes with it. I hope to say that we've actually rewritten the story. But that's for the historians. The lawyer's Magna Carta is one thing. The historian's Magna Carta is another. The popular Magna Carta lives on. We held a great exhibition in the British Library over the summer, and it was opened inevitably by the Prince of Wales. This is a document that celebrates the limitation of monarchical power and is invariably used to invoke the existence of monarchical power today. Prince Charles made a speech announcing that in that damp meadow, he said, was lit the flame of liberty that burns still. He was then taken on a tour of the exhibition and shown the effigy of his great ancestor, King John. And if he's looking a little worried, that's because he's looking at that, which is one of King John's teeth taken out of John's tomb in the 1790s, together with John's thumb bone, so that one can imagine John on the field of Runnymede grinding his teeth in fury and pushing down on the document with his thumb as he signed the document with his right hand. Magna Carta, the commercialization of it continues. Stem ginger fudge, a Magna Carta tea towel, and this is my favorite. For the secret or cultured baby, a Magna Carta pacifier. And notice, this is a real thing. It's down now from $13.70 to $9. But notice that you can buy it for babies and dogs, which is an interesting combination. In the New York Times on the 15th of June this year, there was a quote of the day by a total idiot who said, "The myth of Magna Carta lies at the whole origin of our perception of who we are as an English-speaking people. Freedom-loving, who've lived with a degree of liberty and under a rule of law for 800 years. That, of course, is a load of tripe, but it's a very useful load of tripe." Now, the idiot who said those words was me. So, on that note, I think I will end. Thank you very much.
permission enough to ask a question. But in your sort of rather different world, from my rather different world, are there any heroes? I mean, it seems to me I've seen such a collection of knaves, fools, buffoons, and jackasses. But whether or not there's anybody out there who has a modicum of sense on anything in the world as you see.
I agree with everything that you said and that Judge Williams said about Cook, about the reinterpretation of Magna Carta, about the uses of it in defense of rule of law. I think that there is an enormously heroic story around Stephen Langton. This is the first political program in English history, and they do actually go to war for a political cause. That's a most unusual thing. But I do believe also that there is an enormous amount of hokum around it. And I entirely take Judge Williams's point that to rubbish the document altogether and say that it's all nonsense won't get us anywhere at all. But we do need to divide the reality from the myth.
How come you didn't put something in the nice slide?
Yes, well there is. That's the only commemoration of Langton today, a gastropub outside Guildford.
Very enjoyable and fun, but the reality versus the myth. So there's always a utility in debunking misinterpretations of legal documents or any event in history. And that can serve a lot of healthy purposes. I think in Lepore's debunking article, actually, it was very unhealthy for different reasons, because she was almost accustoming her readers towards complacency. And her answer is to like have a hashtag on instead of actually doing anything. So it's almost something very insidious about her debunking. But this sort of debunking is also a bit like laughing at the dead. I mean, so what,
is that illegal?
laughing at the way that people have invoked Magna Carta over the especially the last couple of hundred years. So Hallam, I mean, I'm drawing on Linda Colley's recent and developing work. Hallam is feeling at once constitutional primacy in 1818 and documentary envy, that we don't have a constitution, so we better write a constitutional history which performs like a substitute for 19th century Britain where there's a debate about whether to have a written constitution or not. And wouldn't it be, in addition to the myth and the reality, figure out how people actually used the myth in particular circumstances, because when we rush through it this quickly, it just seems like everyone's a fool.
Myself included, of course. I mean, I think that there is a disjunction there between that fine and wonderful story of the creation of constitutional history through people like Hallam and Stubbs. But you mentioned 1818. We're in the realm of the Peterloo Massacre. We're in a realm where there is a real fear that there is going to be a revolution. We're in a realm also which is busily taking over large parts of the world using its very large army in an imperial context that if you read it from an Indian or an Irish or a Jamaican or pretty much any standpoint you care to mention, does not say a great deal about the rule of law. And I think the rule of law is a very flexible concept, and I'm very much in favor of its celebration. But at the same time, we must not remember that the rule of law does not necessarily apply when countries are going to war or when they are building themselves empires. So I'm not merely trying to laugh at these people, though obviously I am trying to entertain you. It is Saturday morning and this is New York. But I am trying to entertain you. But at the same time, I think there is a serious point behind all of that, that the popular understanding of this is quite divorced from reality. And that the popular understanding of a lot of this comes out of Scott, who is more or less entirely divorced from reality.
Can I ask, one of the things that strikes me about the Magna Carta is that it's, and this is, I take it true, both of its myth and those who are looking at its so-called reality, is that it's taken as a document that somehow constrains power. And I was wondering if you have a sense, and actually if Judge Williams has a sense, of has it played a role in situations where the challenge is not to constrain power, but to create power? So one can think of many post-colonial contexts where the constitutional challenge is, yes, to constrain power, but to first create the damn thing.
Yes.
You know. So in the Indian case, it seems to me, you don't start with the 18th century suspicion of power as something that is going to be abused. You start with the problem that, look, we could be facing a condition of anarchy. We could be facing a vacuum.
Yes.
And we have to create something now. And under those conditions, as Shruti, I think, mentioned yesterday, at least in the Indian case, the Magna Carta doesn't have a hugely important status. You know, it's invoked here and there. The invocation is very perfunctory. It's nowhere near as the stature that, let's say, the American constitutional founding has for India.
Yes. I think that's very important. It's used in India, but it's always used as a resistance to tyranny, as a resistance to the sovereignty of the English crown. I think that that business about creating power is very important. Richard's point about the opening of the American Constitution, we the people. Magna Carta does not endorse the idea of popular sovereignty. There is no popular sovereignty in Magna Carta. It is a grant by grace from a king to God. The first clause is to God, because you have to grant it to God so that you can't ask for it back. But it isn't even a grant to the freeborn men and women of England in its original clause. It starts off as a grant to God. So if you are trying to create sovereignty ex nihil, it's actually not much use to you.
Yeah.
The only things that are enormously useful are those very vague terms like lawful judgment, judgment by your peers, judgment by the law of the realm, which, as I said yesterday, are incredibly vague. And they do, in the end, take us back to sovereignty, because some sovereign authority has got to decide who actually is or is not acting lawfully.
I want to return to Dan Helsbach's question and your answer to it. I also found the presentation an entertaining way to spend a Saturday morning in New York, and I appreciate the purpose at one level of explaining to us that it isn't what it appears to be, as it were. But I'm curious, in what respect does that advance the question of whether there is any utility to the existence of an exploitation of Magna Carta?
Okay, my answer is very simple, that it matters enormously that we believe that we are freeborn people who have lived for 800 years under the rule of law. It matters enormously that we believe that to be the case, although in a large number of instances it is not true. If you believe that you are a people whose rights are defended by a large army and whose purpose is to conquer large parts of the world, then you will behave in a particular way. If you believe that you are a freeborn people who defend liberty and democracy wherever you go, you will behave in another way. So in a I don't want to use political science language, but in a Sombartian habitus sort of way, there is a very great significance to this.
And what's the utility in debunking it?
None whatsoever. I shouldn't really have come. If I were you, I'd call the police.
Okay, go ahead, Richard.
I do think, in fact, it's nice to talk about the form. I want to just take issue with one technical thing, which is when you say, shall be tried by the law of the land or by due process, that it's incredibly vague. I think there are certainly applications of the principle which are difficult to understand, but the core of the principle is not vague, and in fact it is widely understood and widely shared. And so you talked about Judge Barnum's case, and that was the notion that you have to be tried before an unbiased judge. And if you have a loaded judge, it's like having a loaded pair of dice, you're always going to get something wrong. Mm-hmm. And you can't think of any sensible procedure system which has any substantive objective, which is not going to happen. There's always the notice in this, the old Roman maxim of audi autem partem, must always hear the other side before you decide a case.
because otherwise what's going to happen if you're only one side, it's going to lead to the very kind of bias, and so it's another sort of protection. And then there's always the requirement that there be specific notice of the charges against you so that you could organize the defense of yourself, because otherwise it's the use of arbitrary power. Now, the key thing to understand about this, so these are just not abstract guarantees. If you assume that liberty and property are at stake in all of the cases that are decided before you, essentially, if you allow corrupt procedures, it's going to always allow for confiscation and transfer of wealth in illicit fashion between parties. And I think that element of the thing is there, and the fact that we want to have debates, as we do in the United States, as to whether or not the hearing gives you the right to appear in person in all cases, or only to present documents, or whether or not cross-examination is to be allowed, and so forth, where there are some genuine issues. I mean, I think the correct way to say it is, you get the first three right, you solve 75% of the problem. And the other 25% of the problem we may disagree about, but we never want our doubts over the hard cases to undermine our judgments over the easy cases. And the use of the term vague, I think, conveys the sense that everything is up to grabs, when in fact it has never been the case with the application of these terms, and that's why people care about them so much, because you get rid of this and you're back to the Star Chamber, which was obviously a post-Magna Carta development, but more on a Friday. And I just don't know whether you agree with that.
I think that it is vague, because I think that even in 1610, you would be very hard put to find out what the law of the land was. I mean, to actually find the text of the law of the land, you had to wait till 1810 for the statutes of the realm. I think that there's a disjunction here between the lawyer's idealism behind all of this, which I salute. I think it's magnificent. This is a magnificent ideal. It is a shining city on a hill. This is the law. It is perfect in all its parts, and Cook and others go towards its decoration. But the reality of English law in the 17th and 18th centuries was very, very far from perfect. Indeed, one could argue that the reality of English law in the 19th, 20th centuries is very far from perfect.
You could argue that everywhere. But there's one thing to give into it and surrender and to celebrate the failure of institutions, and another to hold out an ideal as a possible source of correctness.
Yep.
Scott?
Thank you. I thought it was fun, and I understood what you were doing, and so my reaction to it wasn't quite as like Dan and Michael. But here, I think you're the perfect person to kind of react to what we've all done so far here. And here's what I mean by that. I took this to be your dry British wit pointing out the fallacies of Magna Carta in popular culture. Before you did that, though, you pointed out that you're a historian and you have a view of it. And you mentioned that a lot of people in the room are lawyers, and we're bringing that to it. And then Richard's comment at dinner last night, I don't know if you were there or you were preparing this, but he said that no one here, I guess you weren't there, no one here knows anything about Magna Carta, so you clearly weren't at dinner. Wait, let me go. Okay. But then Richard's paper, he says this paper has been reviewed by absolutely nobody, comments earnestly sought. So he's making my own point for me. So here's my question. I mean, we have a lot of bright people writing about something that they're just learning about.
Yep.
And I just wondered what your reaction to it has been.
I believe, and this is going to sound excessively impassioned, but I believe that if you cannot laugh at a system of law, if you cannot actually poke fun at it, then you do risk becoming part of a system of law that is unalterable. It was the ability of people in Britain to laugh at Mussolini or to laugh at Hitler that actually won the Second World War. I think that there is a very great benefit to humor in these things, and that we shouldn't take them too seriously. I think that these events happened a very long time ago, that none of us were there. We don't actually know what the intention of the barons was or the intention of the king. We can only imagine these things. And that we should do that within a human context where we are very fortunate to live under the rule of law. We do live under the rule of law. The rule of law is occasionally broken and suspended and ignored, but we do, I entirely take the point, live under the rule of law. We should be very grateful for these things, but we should not be too solemn about them. Solemnity may be one of the downfalls of the social sciences.
Do you have a question?
Yeah, just I'm thinking about this more from the point of view of what's going to appear in the issue.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to spoil the fun. I mean, this has really been great. So I have the following thought. So one way in which I think we and the issue could enormously gain from your expertise is some kind of comparative analysis where you do this myth bunking, including poking fun at it, and at the end of it tied together with a sense of, you know, this is the real version or what historians consider real, and it has this kind of limited value. Jay-Z is never going to sing about it. It's never going to become this larger than life thing. But that seems to be the accurate version, and there's value in that. Whereas this is the popular version. It's full of all kinds of nonsense, but it seems to have this greater purpose. Like I was telling Tom yesterday, as some kind of coordinating shelling point. So one way to go might be just do it in a slightly comparative fashion rather than the way you've presented it, which is just all the myths one after the other, so we suddenly wonder what the point of it all is. So that's one suggestion. The other is using some other social science format which you may or may not be comfortable with. One that comes to mind is something like Karl Popper's Three Worlds. He talks about everything having three, everything we think of may be part of three different worlds. One is an objective physical object, the other is a mental version of that object,
yes,
and then the interaction of those objects.
Should they be alliterative?
Sorry?
Should they be alliterative? Should they all begin with the same letter?
Yes. So, or no. So, some kind of like social science analysis to set it up and then do the kind of myth bunking that you do. So that's my, it's not a comment or it's just really a suggestion because I'm just thinking about how this is all going to look tied together.
I wouldn't worry too much. What you'll get is actually a fairly dull literary analysis of those novels, which I have now read.
Yeah.
And there are, apart from the correspondences between them, there are all sorts of things that they show about the way that the Victorians viewed good and bad constitutions and non-constitutions that will utterly satisfy the needs of social scientists.
Excellent. Then you will learn twice.
All right.
Is there? Yeah, go ahead.
So I agree that sometimes we should poke fun at things. And yesterday, in my own presentation and in my paper, I emphasized a lot the role of Sir Edward Cook in creating the myth of modern Magna Carta. But in the year 2015, I think sometimes we have made myth busting into a national sport. If you take your average class in US history or your average class in world history, everything is about myth debunking, everything is about, I would say, certain amount of cynicism. And I wonder if, you know, re-emphasizing the point about, oh, you know, we are King John and Walt Disney version, and I actually use the expression Walt Disney in my paper about the Walt Disney version or the Hollywood version of Middle Ages England. If in some sense we are not like in the, and now I'm going to go back to you with humor, Monty Python famous sketch about this is a death parrot, this parrot is no longer, this parrot has ceased to be. Haven't we made already this point enough times over the last 20 years?
Yes, and it's been analyzed now by literary critics and been shown not to be at all funny.
All right.
Whoa.